I'm with Yop Cluck from Yamima. Now, Yop, what is Yamima?
Yamima is an organization which wants to provide care for children and young adults with disabilities. This can be mental disabilities, but this can be also severe physical disabilities. Yamima is already here for 25 years. Originally, it was started by a couple from Holland, and through the years it became more big and more professional. And yeah, that's actually what we want to do. We want to provide care and be a light for these children who are neglected in this area.
Is there not a lot of neglect here with children with disabilities?
Well, every once in a while you hear the stories about neglect, especially more on the countryside, not in the bigger cities, but on the countryside, that especially mentally handicapped children, they are put in a way in closets, or they are living as animals in their houses. They have their own room, and everything that is done in this room. Every once in a while we see an example of it. So yeah, you can say there is some neglect. The biggest problem is that there is no local awareness, not really a local awareness for the situation as it is at the moment. So I think you can speak about neglect, yeah.
But do you have any children here that come from very, very bad children, bad family situations?
Yeah, we have several children here who came out of these situations. An example is two sisters and one brother who are actually all living here, which were taken out of a closet, literally, out of a closet from their house in the north of the West Bank. Yeah, and because they lived already there for many years, they created their own world, you know, and it's very hard to reach them and to make them understand what things are about and these kind of things. So, yeah.
No. Yamima is obviously a charity. Is there government institutions doing the same type of work that you do, or is there no government institution here at all?
Well, there are some governmental institutions here, but they are more focused on one specific target group. Like, for instance, here in Bajala, there is an institution which is specifically for blind people. And I know in Ramallah there's also another society more focused on mental disabilities. As well, there is a mental hospital here in Bethlehem, but you cannot compare it with the care we provide here in Yamima. It's totally different. There's a lack of knowledge, there's a lack of money, a lack of means. But basically, the biggest problem is that people see everything as one. So a blind person is here the same as a person who cannot walk. They are not healthy. So this is how they look towards these people, and this is also how they treat them.
So you brought up basically a Western influence here into somewhere like Bajala and tried to provide and care the best you can for them.
Well, it's not actually that we want to provide a Western influence or something. What we want to do is create some kind of local awareness for the situation which is here and is still continuing. We want to show the people, especially here the local society, that even if you have a child with a disability, there are still a lot of opportunities for this child. It doesn't mean that the child is like hopeless or something. Every child is, in our view, every child is like a gift from God. And most of the people here, they see their disabled child as a punishment of their God, which is actually another God than we are believing in, of course. But we want to show that even a child is disabled, there should be a possibility to let them live and grow up in a normal way and to deal with them in a normal way instead of hiding them or neglecting them or, yeah.
How many children do you have here in the home?
Well, Yamima consists out of two projects, or actually three projects, but like 24-hour care, so permanent residents, we have at this moment 32 children who are we taking care of.
What sort of age ranges do they go from?
The age range is between 3 years old and the oldest one is around 32.
What sort of disabilities do they have?
This is a variety of disabilities. Most of them are physically handicapped. But besides this, there are also mentally handicapped. We have a special section for girls with autism. We have a section for boys who are more dealing with social emotional problems instead of being, as they call it here, retards. Although I don't like the word. Besides this, we have a special care unit. These are the more severe cases, if you want to call it this way, and they need 24-hour care, and they cannot do anything. They are totally depending on the care from somebody else. So it's a whole variety. We have blindness, we do have autistics, we do have children with Down syndrome. So it's a whole variety of handicaps, yeah.
So what would these residents be doing if they didn't come to UMIMA?
Well, that's hard to say. It's really hard to say. You cannot just say they would be living in a terrible situation, because there are parents who really love their children and they are trying to do their best as possible to raise these children in a normal way. I'm afraid that most of the children, they would be in situations that you rather wouldn't have them in like this.
So what sort of care do you give them?
Well, that's a lot. First of all, there is the basic care, of course. It's also depending on the what kind of disability children have, of course. But in the 24-hour care, they are actually living here. So we provide them with a sleeping room. We provide them with food. We provide them with pocket money. We provide them with insurances. Yeah, and besides this, there is the individual care for all these residents. So every resident has his own care plan, in which we are putting goals where we want to go with these children, in which way we want to develop them. And we try to work according to this care plan, and we are, every quarter, we are writing reports to see if we are working according to the plan. And the ways of taking care of them, yeah, it's too much to say in one sentence. Everything is possible here. In the past, we used to do dialysis with one of the children, but it's kind of unique in this situation, in this environment here. Usually it only happens in hospitals, in the specialized hospitals. Besides this, we have activity programs for them, so in this way we are also taking care of them, so it's a lot.
But do some of these older residents actually get out and work in the community?
Some of them do, yeah. But then you are speaking about the more high-level residents, as we call them. And they find their way into society mostly through workshops, especially in this area. The olive wood is very popular. So, for instance, we have one resident who is working in an olive wood factory. Another one has his own shop for leather and shoe repair. Another one is working every now and then here in a hospital in the children's department, just to play with them and to do night activities with them. But we try to push them as much as possible into the society, because they are part of the society. So
why do you think there are so many disabled children in this area?
It's hard to say. Of course, you have your thoughts about it. You are here in a society in which is very common to marry within the family, and it is a fact that nieces and nephews who are marrying, the chance that they receive a child with a disability is much bigger than, let's say, somebody who's not related at all. So this might be one of the reasons, but one specific reason why there is a high amount of disabilities, I'm not sure to say, but this might be one of the reasons.
Now, you also have a school here attached to the place. What sort of things do you do there?
Well, the school is actually, it was started as a day program for the residents, but as we had space and as we had the knowledge, we wanted to expand it, And because of this, we admitted also children from the Bethlehem region to this school. And actually, the school it's a daycare facility, we call it, and it's provided in several classes. These classes are arranged to the level of the children and also the sex, you know, the male, female. We have to be careful with these kind of things, especially here. And according to their level, we are doing activities with them. There is one class who is actually, they are learning how to write and how to read and how to count and some geography. But there's also one class with autistics who are actually learning according to a very, very tight schedule. But a lot of activities, playing outside, making trips around, doing activities with coloring, with pencils, with clay, with chips, these kind of things. We have our own snoozel room where they can train the sight and the hearing and the smelling and these kind of things. And besides this, we also have, for some participants in ABO, we have a program to develop their computer skills. So we have adjusted computer hardware, like for instance you can attach to the wheelchair so they can pick colors with clicking with their head or these kind of things. So in this way we try to develop their skills.
So how many people do you have coming from the community into the school?
We have a few local workers in the school, and I think the amount is around 9. Yeah, 9 teachers. Yeah.
How many residents from the local area?
These are 26.
So is it easy doing this sort of work?
Is it easy to do? No, it's not easy. Difficult in several ways, because to be honest, you always will be a stranger within the culture. As much as you try to adapt to the culture, you will always be a stranger. So sometimes things which are really common here, you just don't understand why it is arranged like this or why it is going like this. That makes it difficult. That's one thing. The second thing is that what also makes it difficult is that you are always depending. You are always depending on others. We are a charitable organization. At the moment, we are very happy with the situation if you look to the finances. But we also had moments not that long ago that it was really tight if we could pay the salaries or these kind of things. So this is also something which makes it difficult. You want to develop and you want to expand and you want to implement things, and it's not always possible just because of money. That's another difficult thing. A third difficult thing is that not always we have the feeling that the cooperation from the local authorities, and then I'm speaking about the Palestinian as well, the Israeli authorities, is that good, you know. I will not say that it's that they are working against us, absolutely not, but sometimes you get the feeling that they are not really working with us, let me put it this way.
The cost practically as well, feeding a lot of kids and moving them from A to B must be very difficult as well.
This is really true. You know, once we did a calculation what it costs to be a resident within Yemima, then afterwards we made a calculation what it costs to let Yemima exist for one day. And if you are working with a budget of 400,000 euro a year, you can say that Yemima is a little 1,000 euro a day. Most of it is expenses in food and in lodging and in medicines and in, of course, also salaries for the personnel. Then it's quite hard sometimes, yeah.
You're originally from Holland. Why did you come here and why do you do what you do?
Well, it's actually through my sister. My sister, she worked here as a volunteer almost 10 years ago. And this is how I became known with the name of Yemima. And when I finished my study, I was like, okay, maybe I want to travel abroad, maybe 1 year, like adventure, you know. And the name Yemima came into my head because it was a known name within our family. So I applied, and they hired me, and that was my first meeting with Yemima. Yeah, and that was 4 years ago now.
And you have a website for people who would like to know more?
Yeah, it's www.yemima.nl, and there is it's a Dutch website, but there's also English information, and there's information in Arabic who are interested.
If you just want to spell Yemima, that would be really good.
That's J-E-M-I-M-A, Yemima.